everybody. Thank you for braving the horrors of network outage and Zoom nonsense for the 2022 Jones Lecture. And as always, I am so happy to be here. I'm Catherine Mooney. I'm the Jim Jones Associate Professor of History here. I came here in 2014 because Jim had finally decided that maybe it was time to take a break after 57 years. I know that I and everybody I work with think about him every day. And this is one of my favorite events in the calendar because it gives us an opportunity to think about him and the marvelous teaching he did and all the things he was so interested in. And one of the things that he cared about most passionately, if you spent 5 minutes with him, was sports. And so it has always been one of my most important goals to get a preeminent sports historian to do this lecture. And I am so excited that I actually managed to secure my personal favorite preeminent sports historian to do this lecture. Dr. Pamela Grundy comes to us from Charlotte, North Carolina, and she has been doing, I think, groundbreakingly insightful and beautifully written American cultural history for her whole career. Certainly it was formative for my career. I think one of the reasons I do this is because of her work. She is the author of numerous books, including most recently Legacy, Three Centuries of Black History in Charlotte, North Carolina. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. She's also the author of Learning to Win, Sports, Education, and Social Change in 20th Century North Carolina, Color and Character, West Charlotte High and the American Struggle Over Educational Equality, American Sports, From the Age of Folk Games to the Age of the Internet, and Shattering the Glass, The Remarkable History of Women's Basketball. Her talk today, which is entitled Strong and Fearless, the WNBA and the Fight for Racial Justice, includes some of the work she's doing in preparation for the new edition of Shattering the Glass. And we ask that you enjoy the talk and hold your questions until the end. And if you would please, when we do get to the end, send me the questions in the chat so that I can read them out to our speaker, just so there's no confusion and we can make sure everything proceeds in orderly fashion. And please join me in welcoming Dr. Grundy to FSU.
Well, thanks so much, Catherine. I admire your work tremendously as well, and it's quite an honor to be cited as a someone who inspired you to do it, because you are really moving forward. Nothing like seeing younger people in the field really take off and shine. So I'm excited about that. Really happy to be here to talk about women's basketball. And I just have to start. I'm going to start by sharing my screen, and then I'm going to go to my desktop. I'm going to go through all of these steps that are needed in order to make a screen sharing happen. I think sometimes I ought to be able to and play from start. All right, there we go. With a picture that I just love. I just have to start with an image of one of the teams that's headed to the Women's Final Four this weekend, the regional champion, University of South Carolina, coached by the legendary Dawn Staley. Just look at these proud, strong, exhilarated women. It's been a great tournament to this point, even though no North Carolina team made it, sadly, to the Final Four. It should be an even better weekend. Women's basketball is just thriving, and a great reward for more than a century of effort to build the sport. So when Catherine asked me to do this talk, it was pretty clear I should talk about women's basketball. The Final Four is coming up, especially the Women's Final Four. First year, they actually get to be March Madness, which they weren't allowed to use before. So it's step by step all the time. And it's also partly because I love the subjects, one of my favorite subjects to talk about, because the characters are just so marvelous. The stories are just so marvelous. The title of this talk, Strong and Fearless, comes from a statement made by the members of the Atlanta Dream WNBA basketball team in the summer of 2020, as they stood up to a team owner's effort to mute the league's support for the Black Lives Matter movement. But I'm going to start this talk actually a little earlier than that, looking at a few efforts that show what basketball has done for women and the many ways that women have helped to build the sport by rising to the challenge of different times and different places. Throughout more than a century of women's basketball, strength and fearlessness have taken many forms. In fact, for much of women's basketball history, playing basketball has involved defying limitations placed on women's action. Again, that's one reason it's such an exciting subject to look at. And as a result, women's basketball history is full of strong, creative characters, each of whom is fascinating in her own way. So I'm going to start with a few of my favorites. First here is Senda Berenson, who was more fearless than perhaps she looks in her neat little bloomers standing in her gymnasium. Senda Berenson's journey to basketball was a long one. She was born in the 19th century in Lithuania, and her family came to the US when she was 7 and settled in Boston. Now, Senda was a lively, smart girl. She had a strong and stubborn will, people say. But by the time she was a teenager, she had developed a mysterious illness that kept her from sitting or standing for very long. Determined to change her future and her prospects, she enrolled in the newly opened and somewhat controversial Boston Normal School of Gymnastics, which promised to train women in physical education and build physical strength. And she soon found out that all she had needed was a little exercise. It is impossible to tell how my life had altered, she later explained about the strength and confidence that she developed. And she also saw the broader importance of this transformation for the prospects of women such as her, who weren't necessarily expected under Victorian tenets to be strong or fearless. One of the strong arguments in the economic world against giving women as high salaries as men for similar work is that women are more prone to illness than men, she once wrote. They need, therefore, all the more to develop health and endurance if they decide to become candidates for equal wages. So she had big ambitions. After she graduated, she got a job at Smith College. And one day she picked up an article in which another young instructor, a man named James Naismith, described a game he'd newly invented, which he called basketball. Berenson was intrigued, and she began immediately to introduce basketball to her classes. Basketball was a game that had been invented to play in gymnasiums because there weren't a lot of good, vigorous games to play inside. And it was perfect for her. And she saw the significance of the game in terms of strength, but also in terms of joy. She wrote once, many women are well enough in a way, and yet they never know the joy of mere living. Let such a person try this game. She will forget herself at the first throw of the ball. We'll take deep draughts of air with the unaccustomed exercise and tingle and throb with the joy of the game. So it's a whole person experience that she's describing here, building strength, joy, and confidence. But at the same time, she had to be careful. Physical exuberance and especially competitive zeal at that time were really seen as qualities that belonged to men. Young women who were attending college were already breaking some of the barriers between men's and women's fears as conceived of in the Victorian times. And so Berenson shaped a game that gave her students the opportunity to play, but also created a distinctly female version of basketball. Her rules, as you can see in this slide, divided the court into three sections, and each player had to stay in her assigned section, which minimized movement. She only allowed a single dribble per possession. So again, not too much running around, and forbade any kind of physical contact. So no fouling at all. So this creates a game that allows women to play, and they had a huge amount of fun playing because even with these rules, it was much more than they had ever done, but that also made it acceptable, made it possible for women to play and keep playing. And even with these controls, the game becomes enormously popular. By the 1910s, I mean, within a short period of time, women are playing the sport in schools large and small across the country. And Senda Berenson, the woman who at one point could hardly sit up by herself, became known as the mother of women's basketball. The next person that I want to look at is a woman named Ora Washington. She also traveled a long and winding path to basketball significance. From the mid-1920s through the late 1930s, Ora Washington was without question the greatest Black female athlete in the nation. She dominated both basketball and tennis. You see her here in this picture with some of the many tennis trophies she won over her long career. But she actually didn't start playing either sport until she was in her 20s. Washington had been born just before the turn of the century on a family farm in rural Caroline County, Virginia. And although the Washingtons owned their own land, and like many Black families in that era, times were tight, especially for a family that had 10 children. So when Ora was a teenager, she and a sister packed up and headed for Philadelphia to look for work. And now her timing in this could hardly have been better. She arrives just at the time that women's basketball is beginning to take off in rural and working class communities around the country. And we can shift to some of these slides showing some of these young women's teams from around the country. In the 1920s were an exciting time for women. They gained the right to vote. They tossed away corsets and long skirts for more comfortable garb, and they stepped into public in bold new ways. And in communities where women picked cotton, where they worked at factory jobs, or where they did other kinds of physical labor, there were few questions about whether a woman could run up and down a basketball court or even take a foul or two. Senda Berenson and her contemporaries had established basketball as an acceptable sport for young women, and in the newly energetic climate of the 1920s, it was spreading rapidly across the country. So this is a team from Winchester Avenue in Union County, North Carolina. This is a team from Ida Grove High School. The Iowa State champions. I mean, just look at those faces. They have a little bit different look than the South Carolina women, but you can still see that pride. You can still see the glow that playing basketball can give you. Here's a group actually of young Native American women from Native American schools who are playing in a school tournament in Rapid City. Again, you see women who obviously are comfortable with themselves and who love to play. Now, Ora Washington, to go back to Ora, she got her start at the colored branch of the YMCA in the Philadelphia suburb of Germantown. She was an immediate phenomenon. Only a few years after taking up tennis, as I said, she was the Black national champion, the best Black female player anyone had seen. When she turned to basketball, her main team, I'm switched there, was the Philadelphia Tribunes, sponsored by the city's main Black newspaper. And there's a picture of the Tribunes, and Ora is, let me see, I've got my cursor. Ora is right here to the right of the outlet that's so strategically placed down there in the picture. Throughout the 1930s and into the 1940s, the Tribunes took on all comers, Y teams, factory teams, and even Black college teams. And I'm going to switch for a minute back here to the Tuskegee team. It's interesting, while white women's colleges usually didn't play competitive basketball, Black women's colleges took up the game with zeal. Again, you have a little bit different sense of what's appropriate for women to do. And so you have women from places such as Tuskegee, such as Bennett, playing and shining on the court. Here in the second row, you have here, left to right, this woman here is Alice Coachman, who actually become the first Black female athlete to win a Olympic gold medal. She'll do that in 1948 in the high jump at the Olympics. So you have just all these women playing, but Ora is really far and above the greatest player. And it's important to say, and you can see this in this picture too, she wasn't girly. Ora had a very distinctive approach to the game. She didn't hide her strength. She just astonished because she was that good. Ora can do everything required of a basketball player. One sports writer wrote, she passes and shoots with either hand. She is a ball hawk. She has stamina and speed that make many male players blush with envy. And despite elaborate defenses, especially matched out to stop her, she has averaged 16 points per game with a high total of 38 points in one game. No one who ever saw her play could forget her, one fan later recalled, nor could anyone who met her. And I actually believe Ora's accomplishments are on the verge of gaining greater influence because she played in a Black community, in a Black world, and did not make it to the integrated era with stars such as Jackie Robinson or Althea Gibson. She ended up getting somewhat forgotten. Her career ended before desegregation began. But now, as folks have been digging into the stories, really bringing out her accomplishments, learning more about her, she was recently inducted into the Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame. And there's going to be more coming out about her in a new multi-part podcast that the BBC is doing on her life. I'm helping a little bit with that. And I think it's going to be extraordinary. It's really going to give us some insights into this woman who achieved so much. So we've got Ora. And then another favorite of mine is Hazel Walker. And Hazel is there in the middle on holding the basketball. This is the picture of Hazel Walker's Arkansas Travelers. And I also just love this picture because it just says so much about what these women are doing, both their confidence and the way that they present themselves. Hazel took obviously a different tack from Ora Washington. She was an exceptional player. She won multiple amateur athletic union championships, but she wanted more. She wasn't satisfied with just playing the company team. She wanted to make money playing basketball, and she thought she could do it. And so she started a barnstorming team, Hazel Walker's Arkansas Travelers. She's from Arkansas. And this is a team that toured throughout the South and the Midwest playing basically a game a day for several months. And most of the time they played men's teams. That's who was out there to play. So most of the time they're going, rolling into town, playing the local men's team and usually beating them because they played every day. They were basically professionals and they were great shots. And so they beat most of the teams they played. But as you can see from this picture, Hazel cleared space for herself when her team with a trick that a lot of women's basketball players of the era used. While they played hard on the court, they presented an impeccable version of conventional womanhood off the court. Again, you see that in the picture. The hair, the makeup, the careful poses. This was all by design. Hazel Walker said you had to curl your hair if you wanted to play for her. You had to wear your lipstick. And you had to smile and you had to be very mannerly. We had to act like ladies. And when we came out of the motel room, we had to be fully dressed, player Doris Coleman once said. Everything had to be perfect. These were stringent rules, but they opened the space for these women to have the chance to keep playing the game that they loved. And as all of you may have noticed, to this point, the stories jumped around a little bit. From place to place and time to time. And there's a reason for that, not just because these are the people that I picked. In this era, really up until the 1970s, it required a particular constellation of factors to create support for women's basketball. You had to have people who were interested in doing it. You had to have communities that would support it. You had to have people who knew how to present it so that it would fit in with community norms while also challenging them. And competitive women's basketball, the kind of basketball that was played by stars such as Ora Washington and Hazel Walker, tended to thrive in more marginal communities. This was not part of mainstream culture at this point, of the dominant middle-class culture that dominated most national institutions. It thrived in rural communities, in working-class communities, in textile communities. So you have this scattering of teams across marginal communities, as opposed to the more ubiquitous spread of men's basketball. And that made the sport vulnerable. In fact, as the 1950s dawn, with the pressure of the worldwide Cold War, this constellation of sport, of support for women's basketball becomes harder and harder to hold together. Of course, as anyone who's done history knows, this is an era of tremendous anxiety, which sparks new pressures to conform to a narrow set of largely middle-class social norms, white middle-class social norms, that included an emphasis on gender divisions, a man's world and a woman's world. And part of this pressure also involves an intense fear-mongering directed at LGBTQ individuals who are portrayed as dangerous to society and to the nation. And this particular part of that attack also challenges and further marginalizes women who are playing a man's sport. So there's a whole range of pressures on women who are doing something that does not seem to fit into the neat box or the suburban kitchen. And it made it harder to walk this line that Hazel Walker had negotiated so effectively a little bit earlier. And in fact, a lot of existing women's basketball teams are disbanded during this era. And instead of basketball, you get an increasingly feminized version of cheerleading that was elevated to the pinnacle of female popularity in many schools. Cheerleading actually had once been a men's activity. And when women first started to cheerlead, there were all these concerns about whether they would be strong enough or whether they would ruin their voices. But essentially, particularly as you see this divide open between men and women, cheerleading becomes a more exclusively female endeavor. And so you get that very neatly. And here in this particular picture, again, another one of my favorite pictures, this is a small Pennsylvania high school, and the African-American woman all the way over to the left, right here, this is Vivian Stringer, one of the greatest women's basketball coaches in American history. When she reached high school in Edenton, Pennsylvania in 1960, cheerleading was her only option. Stringer was one of the best basketball players, male or female, in the community. She spent all her time on the local pickup court, and her play was so valued that her male teammates would actually come to her house to help her do her chores so that she could get out to the court with them faster. But there was no institutional support for a female basketball player in that place at that time. So she became a cheerleader because that was the closest that she could get to the playing field. And actually, the NAACP had to threaten a lawsuit to get her even on the cheerleading team. But that's another story. But this lack of institutional support didn't stop her. As a cheerleader, she whispered advice to her male friends as they came on and off the football team and the basketball court. You know, she could see where the holes were, she could see what they weren't doing, and she would give them advice. And then in 1971, she gets a job coaching women's basketball at historically Black Cheney State University, and sets to work. Of course, she'll eventually move on to Rutgers. But what is starting to make that possible, you're getting some more institutional support, is of course that that powerful supporter of rights, and sometimes the federal government. And it would essentially take federal legislation followed by a lot of hard work to put women's basketball on a more secure footing. This is Martha Griffiths, representative from Michigan, who was one of the congressional members who helped push through the landmark legislation known as Title IX that would revolutionize women's sports. Of course, Title IX is 50 years old this year. We're going to see a lot of celebration this summer. And the wording of it is actually, if you've been watching the final of the women's basketball tournament, a number of teams have the wording of Title IX on the back of their warm-up shirts. Now, Title IX, sometimes people don't realize, wasn't targeted athletics. It was not an athletic piece of legislation. It was about equality in education as a whole. But because sports had become a key part of the American educational system, it ends up transforming women's athletics, including basketball, and essentially giving it a level of support that can't be taken away. Now, of course, it's important to emphasize that just passing a law did not change women's sports. Just passing a law never changes anything. But what a federal law does is it gives the people who are fighting for the opportunity to play or the opportunity to vote, it gives them a tools that they can use and that can become very powerful. It took a long struggle on many fronts, administrative, athletic, legal, et cetera, to convince most college administrators that they had no choice but to fund women's sports. I mean, this is a decades-long struggle. There were some administrations that took women's sports seriously, and particularly women's basketball, especially in areas where there had remained a degree of tradition of women's basketball. Tennessee is an example, where Pat Summitt was such a great coach. There had always been women's basketball in Tennessee. Texas is another great example, where there were athletic administrators that understood women's sports. But in most places, real progress actually doesn't come until the 1990s. Supporters argue and they file complaints and they talk more. And eventually it takes a series of lawsuits in the 1990s to convince administrations that they are that they're going to have to provide a serious level of support for women's sports. And basketball benefits from this particularly because it's one of the sports where there is a one-to-one correspondence with men. You can look and say, the men's basketball team's getting this. The women's basketball team needs to get this too. It's easier than, for example, with football and field hockey. You know, can't do that with these sports that aren't played by both teams. And because in general, men's basketball is getting a lot because it's a big deal on campus, women's basketball benefits from that as well. Now, of course, plenty of inequalities remain. Just need to take a look at the jarring contrast we all saw between last year's men's and women's basketball tournaments, so brilliantly illustrated by young female players who took to social media to make clear that what was being done was not equal. At most schools, the sport has reached a point where its supporters don't have to spend half their time just making it possible to play. So there's now more space. Interesting to note that one of the things about the disparity last year was to realize that though the NCAA was happy to take over women's sport when it started getting funding, they actually are not covered by Title IX. The NCAA organization and the events that they worked very hard to keep themselves from being covered by Title IX. So the inequalities in the men's and women's tournaments were embarrassing, but not technically illegal, which is very interesting, as opposed to if that was the difference that you saw at an individual school between what the men got and what the women got. So that was something I didn't know, and it was very telling. But as they build these programs, coaches like Vivian Stringer, here's Vivian Stringer, a little bit older there in the red shirt, Tara Vanderveer here on the left. She's got her team in the final four this year, Stanford, reigning champions. Pat Summitt, Gino Ariano, also in the final four with UConn for the 14th straight tournament, have now nurtured generations of players. They've all been coaching for decades. They've nurtured players. They've created connections and cultures. And they've brought young women to ever higher levels of performance, which is what we see on the court now, and the sport to growing prominence, particularly with the advent of social media, which has made it possible to reach past the mainstream media that doesn't necessarily give full respect to women's sports and directly reach fans through the efforts of players and coaches. So these programs, because they are backed by this federal legislation, are not going away anytime soon. So we've got a real change. So these are all things that my co-author Susan and I chronicled in Shattering the Glass, a lot of these developments. And I now want to turn to this new piece of the project, which is a little more speculative because I'm looking at things that are more recent. You know, we historians trying to do recent history makes you nervous, and it's a different kind of work, but very exciting because of the changes that have taken place, particularly with the WNBA. Now the WNBA started play 25 years ago. Now, last year they had their 25th anniversary. So 25 years after Title IX, you get the first women's professional basketball league that actually lasts more than a couple of years. There had been a number of efforts to start professional leagues for women, but they had folded quickly. The WNBA, in part because it could draw on the support of the exceedingly wealthy NBA, was able to get over that initial hump and persist. And for a long time, when people talked about professional basketball, it was sort of in terms of these individual players, providing an opportunity for them to keep playing, to build their skills, to realize their potential. And the WNBA does that. But it's more than that. And that's what's really interesting to me. It provides an arena where this talented assortment of women have more independence, more control, and more time to mature as players and as people. And so I think it is a whole new game in that sense, as opposed to you have colleges, there's the old adage that that high school basketball is about communities, college basketball is about coaches, because players just, you know, come through and come through and come through. And then professional basketball is about the players. And I think you see this developing in the WNBA. And one place you can see the significance of having a professional league is something that might be, might seem a little unexpected, but it's a major step that women's basketball has taken in the past decade, which is the acknowledgement and celebration of LGBTQ players, coaches, and fans. And it's hard to overestimate. There's been a lot of good work done on this, but it's hard to overestimate the damage that was done to the sport by decades of efforts to either suppress or obscure the presence of LGBTQ players on women's teams. Of course, that's a story that sadly has a good amount of significance right now, and maybe we can get into some of that in the question period. Some of the most toxic aspects of this appeared in college programs, where for many years, a number of coaches were openly hostile to LGBTQ players, and where recruiting could be plagued by whisper campaigns in which some coaches sought to lure recruits by suggesting to their parents that what rival teams were hotbeds of lesbian activity, were full of LGBTQ players. And so this was sort of an ugly piece of developing competition in women's college basketball. But that's changed. I mean, that's one of the major changes since we did the book. And here, I think the story of Brittany Griner is telling. And as I put this picture of Brittany up, I do want to acknowledge you know, where she is right now, which is caged in a Russian prison. And it is not at all clear what's going to happen to her, when she might get to come home, whether she's going to be sentenced to a long stint in prison, what the conflict between the war and Ukraine effect that has on efforts to get her and bring her home. And so I just want to underscore that we need to keep thinking about Brittany. We need to keep talking about Brittany. We can't let her just get forgotten in that cell. Of course, she's got friends and family who are paying attention, but also I think the general public needs to remain aware of what she's experiencing and doing what we can when we figure it out to help bring her home. But Brittany was a tall, strong girl growing up with a deep voice, and she endured endless bullying from schoolmates because, again, she didn't fit that womanly model. I mean, we still have not gotten away from that. But then she discovered basketball, and her self-confidence began to grow as she became 6'8", tremendously strong, just an extraordinary player. She began to identify as gay in high school, but when she moved on to play college ball for Baylor, she felt pressured to keep that part of her identity under wraps. She wasn't condemned, but you weren't supposed to talk about it, in part because of Baylor's conservative alumni. Baylor was a Baptist school. And again, in part because of the recruiting dilemma. But once Brittany graduates and joins the WNBA as the number one pick, she drops that pretense. That's an important moment. This is the 2013. She shows off her tattoos. She discusses her love for women in the press. And she signs a contract with Nike to model men's sporting attire, becoming the first openly gay athlete to win a Nike endorsement. And that meant a great deal to her. And she said it very clearly in one of her first interviews, "It feels so good saying it. I am a strong Black lesbian woman. Every single time I say it, I feel so much better." And it turns out that a lot of people were ready to hear that. Not everybody, but many, many people. If anything, her honesty made her a more popular figure in women's sporting circles. And in fact, by 2013, the WNBA administrators are also coming to realize that this kind of openness is what that particular group of fans wants. WNBA fans shared a love of female strength and support for a broad range of gender expression. So a league that had also once sought to downplay their LGBTQ fans and players began to sponsor Pride Nights and to celebrate them the light on my iPad is changing and making it harder to read. I bought it. So this league starts to celebrate LGBTQ fans and players, to sponsor Pride Nights, and this strengthens their support. It builds connections in the community, lets fans who had felt somewhat slighted see that they really did matter, and giving players new confidence. In fact, Seattle Storm star Sue Bird described the difference that the shift made in the league. In 2002, when Bird was drafted number one into the WNBA from UConn, she was uneasy about the mismatch between her sexuality and the WNBA's feminine promotion, which it had at the time. And she said, "I was kind of like looking at myself in the mirror, like, no, 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 you're not gay. This is not you." She was drafted by the Seattle Storm, and in the ensuing years, piled up honors and accolades, and grew privately more comfortable with herself and her relationships. But once the league opened up as well, the difference was palpable. "Plainly and simply, we've finally kind of embraced who we are," she said recently. "We're just being authentic." Now, authentic could have many meanings, gay or straight, makeup or not, high style or dressed down. And one thing I love about the WNBA is they got all sorts of women. I mean, you see all different kinds of women. Again, some dress the nines and put on the eyelashes and wear the high heels, and some just, you know, go around in warm-up suits. And so you really can see all of that there. And I think that's really beautiful. At the core is strength, courage, and joy. And that confidence will translate, I believe, to other arenas. It also, the other thing that the WNBA does is give players the chance to build more long-term relationships. Here you see Brittany Griner and Diana Taurasi as a case in point. Griner joined the Phoenix Mercury. Taurasi had already been a star there for a decade. And the two women have now played together for nearly a decade longer, learning from each other all the way, a different kind of learning, a different kind of friendship that you form in college. And I could cite many other examples of this. So the power of this culture and of these close relationships has shown, as the majority African-American league has contended with how to address the Black Lives Matter movement, which has sparked by the deaths of unarmed African-Americans that galvanized the nation starting in 2014. And one such moment came in 2016, when members of the Minnesota Lynx team, the reigning national champions at the time, found themselves in their city at the epicenter of national attention. That June, Philando Castile was shot and killed by a police officer in the Lynx hometown, becoming a part of a series of shocking incidents. I mean, I just remember my disbelief. You knew things were happening, but things to happen all at once included the shooting death of Alton Sterling in Baton Rouge and of a group of police officers in Dallas. And Lynx members decided they had to address what was happening in their community. They held a somber press conference. You see an image from that here, wearing practice t-shirts that on the back bore the names of Castile and Sterling along with the Dallas police shield. And they spoke clearly and from the heart. Racism and unjust phobic fear of Black males and disregard of Black females is very real, Lynx player Rebecca Brunson said. When we look at the facts, it's hard to deny that there's a real problem in our society. I'm scared for my brothers and sisters, my nieces and nephews, my future son or daughter. And along with the names on the front, as you can see on the left, the shirt said, change starts with us, as well as justice and accountability. Now their stance sparked strong reactions. Some of the off-duty police officers who provided security at Lynx games walked out. The WNBA initially leveled fines on this unapproved attire that they were wearing as they warmed up. But their fellow players and many of their fans had their backs. Other WNBA teams began to wear Black shirts at practice. Players refused to answer questions about basketball at press conferences and talked about racial violence instead. And faced with this broader support from players and from fans, the league backed down and rescinded the fines. And it was after that, in August, that San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick decided to sit and then to kneel during the national anthem to make a statement about police brutality. He got more attention, but the Lynx was there early on. So I'll move from my sort of last piece to the summer of 2020. And the need for Black Lives Matter has remained strong. Donald Trump is president. There have been more and more deaths, most dramatically of George Floyd, choked to death by an officer on a Minnesota street. And Breonna Taylor, shot dead by police as she slept in her own bed in her own apartment in Louisville, Kentucky. So protests around the country have escalated, partly because of the pandemic, partly because of just the outrage that has built. And they're drawing harsh critiques from right-wing politicians and Trump supporters on the verge of the presidential election. And as WNBA players prepare together to play in their wubble in COVID quarantine in Bradenton, Florida, they're determined to stay engaged. And their approach showed some of the steps that they had taken since the spontaneous demonstrations in the summer of 2016. Months of careful planning, in fact, produced a sweeping announcement that the WNBA and the Players Union had created a social justice council that would seek to become a driving force of necessary and continuing conversations about race, voting rights, LGBTQ plus advocacy, and gun control, along with other issues. So they plan to open their first games wearing warm-up shirts that said Black Lives Matter, and to play throughout the season in uniforms that bore Breonna Taylor's name, keeping her life and death, because women's deaths often didn't get the attention of men's in public view. And that announcement drew a strong reaction from a very particular quarter. President Trump had recently appointed Kelly Loeffler, the part owner of the Atlanta Dream, to one of Georgia's Senate seats. Loeffler faced a tough Republican primary fight against arch-conservative U.S. Representative Doug Collins. When the league announced its plans, she struck back with angry statements that denounced Black Lives Matter and demanded that the league drop its efforts. And despite the risk involved in challenging one of the people who owned their team and employed them, members of the Dream did not back down. Instead, they issued their own poised, firm statement signed by all the players, which is up here. We are the women of the Atlantic Dream. We are women who support a movement. We are strong and we are fearless. Black Lives Matter. I mean, they could not have been clearer than that. Poised, firm, very clear. And players across the league began to call for Loeffler to sell a portion of the team. But the work didn't stop there. As Dream members contended with the fallout from taking that stand, players from other teams stepped in to plan next steps. Again, you see these relationships, you see this unity among the WNBA players. And they decided that given Loeffler's position of power and the political traction that she seemed to be getting from her attacks on the league, they needed to do more than just defend themselves. So they researched Loeffler's potential Democratic opponents, consulting with a number of people, including Georgia political phenomenon Stacey Abrams, and decided to support Reverend Raphael Warnock. They printed up Vote Warnock shirts to wear on court and supported his campaign through social media and other activities. The nationwide publicity drawn by that daring act drew support to Warnock and also to the league. Warnock's fundraising soared after they made their endorsement, and WNBA television ratings also jumped significantly. There was an audience for this. They had supporters, not everyone, but a lot of people. And again, the importance of being able to reach out to people that that can back you. So you might ask, sort of in conclusion or is beginning of the question period, where do all these different stories lead us? I've taken you on a long and winding trip through women's basketball, but I think together these stories tell us a lot about women and also about social change. I taught the history of the civil rights movement for a good bit in the 1980s and 1990s. Some of you teachers probably remember this. And students would often ask, when is this going to happen again? We need change. When is it going to come? But as the New York Liberty's Laisha Clarendon noted, protest is a long march. Persistence, determination, and relationship building, qualities so essential to top-level basketball, build cultural muscles as well as physical ones, muscles that are ready when the right time comes. In terms of the civil rights movement, this has given rise, as many of you know, to the concept of the long civil rights movement, which focuses on the decades of organization and preparation that African Americans put into racial justice before the cultural stars aligned and nationwide change became genuinely possible on a grand scale. Now, you can't necessarily draw a direct line from all those efforts to the events of the 1950s and the 1960s, but it mattered that they were undertaken. It's a constellation of activity that prepares people for when they will need to act. And I hope that you can see that in this long history of women's basketball, with generations of different women rising to the moment that they were in, demonstrating women's possibilities, building, setting examples, building institutions, first in a scattering of individual teams, and then in a college system, and then in a professional league. So in the summer of 2020, when a moment came that crystallized a particular set of issues and often offered a path for action, WNBA players could draw on this long history of courage, conviction, and strong ties of support to take that path. People ask, what makes women basketball players so good at this? Sue Bird explained. We just literally had to fight for ourselves for so long. And they didn't just take stands, they had an effect. As we know, Raphael Warnock won the Democratic primary and then beat Loeffler for the Senate seat, throwing the chamber to the Democrats. And sometime next week, Warnock will vote to confirm Ketanji Brown Jackson as the first Black woman to serve on the Supreme Court. Now, you can't chalk all this up to the efforts of the WNBA, but they were ready to rise to the occasion when it arrived, and they took effective action. To move briefly away from basketball, Ella Baker, the great civil rights activist who's experienced astute guidance, provided invaluable support to the young activists of the Student Nonviolent Coordinate Committee, believed that everyone has a role to play in social change, but not everyone can or should play the same role. In women's basketball, there have been roles for strategists such as Cinda Berenson and Hazel Walker. There have been roles for determined stars such as Ora Washington. There have been roles for coaches such as Vivian Stringer and self-confident players such as Brittany Griner. So I will leave you with the admonition to look carefully for people playing these many roles, all of them in history, to look for them, all of them in life, and to look for them as we all tune into what should be a marvelous women's Final Four. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I was actually having a moment struggling with my mute button because I've been almost crying for several minutes now. So it's just, okay, I'm game face.
There we go. Game face. Yeah.
Game
better
face.
Eyes for the moment.
If folks will put their questions in the chat, I will pass them along to the speaker.
Now you've got your question waiting, right? So that to fill in the time while people are.
Well, I do, but actually Jen Coslow has leapt in. And she wants to know about, this is a great question. I wish I thought of it. She wants to know about how the Olympics fit into the trajectory of the story.
Well, I think that it is a great question. And the challenge is you can't talk about everything. You have to read the book, especially the new version when it comes out. But
and the Olympics, both editions.
Both editions. By the regular one now, and then when the new one comes out, and I don't know, but it'll be a while, but a year or more. But the Olympics is very important because, again, it provides an international stage. And what helps build institutions and makes things culturally significant is when they have a stage and people care what's accomplished on it. So the Olympics gives women's basketball this kind of stage before they'd even got the college stage, really, starting in 76, I think, is the first women's basketball team with great. If you haven't seen the Queen of the Court, the on Lucia Harris that just won the Academy Award for a short documentary about the great star from Mississippi who played on that Olympic team and also on a couple of national championship teams. You know, it showed it. It gave them women the stage. You could see them playing and people cared. And so that plays a role. And in fact, the WNBA really has its genesis in an effort to push the 1997 Olympic team. There was, again, a sense that women's basketball was improving. They really wanted to push for a professional league. And so there was a entire plan to take a team, keep them together for a year, and they played games all across the country and showcased how good women's basketball had gotten, then went to Atlanta and won the gold medal in fine style again. And that was the kind of platform that no other women's basketball game really had at that point. So the Olympics has really picked that up and has also been the kind of relationship building. Again, Olympic teams often have veterans and young stars. And I think it's so fascinating, this bringing old and young together and having them learn from each other, like Brittany Griner and Diana Taurasi. So the Olympics has done that as well.
I have a question that's, I guess, comparative. And so, kind of too big. And so, pick out the part of it you want. But just speaking as a fan and as somebody who follows this, the comparison you always get is, well, the WNBA does this, the NBA would never do it, right? I mean, and to what degree is that about sort of what Sue Bird's talking about, where she says, well, they just sort of have a different conception of what the possibilities are, what the necessities are. And to what degree is that about different places for those leagues in sort of the popular imagination, so that the NBA can say our corporate future won't allow us to, or we're going to approach this differently or whatever. So, I mean, just sort of thinking of it as a corporate entertainment story, right? That the WNBA discovers that it sort of has a different place kind of by trial and error and by being pushed by its players.
Well, I think that, part of it is that, these are women who have fought, who know you have to fight and who know, if they say, it's up to us, the league's head on their shirts, if not me, who, if not now, when? And I think that when you've been engaged in struggle, you perhaps understand that a little bit more clearly. I think it also, to some degree, has to do with fans. I think women's basketball has a more what you might call progressive group of fans, because those are the sorts of people who follow women's basketball, which is, not the mainstream. I mean, it's a challenging thing to watch women be strong and creative and, well, not creative, but, to watch women be strong and competitive. And so I think that their fans, again, once the league realized that, I think a turning point from that league was realizing that they were not shooting at, the mainstream culture, that there was a strong, group of people out there who really wanted to see what, what they had, and who celebrated that. So I think that's true. I mean, the NFL is even better. They blackball Colin Kaepernick, and they could get away with that. I mean, they chose to do it and could get away with that because they had a whole lot of fans who did not like what he did. There wasn't that same kind of pushback that the WNBA felt when the Lynx made their initial move, and they, knew was there. So I would say, I think that that's part of it too. In lots of ways, sometimes people say, well, the women don't have so much to lose, but they've actually got more to lose. If half the NBA fans went away, they'd still have a ton of money. But, and all the players could retire anyway now, but the women, it's risky. It was risky for them to do, but again, I think they knew it needed to be done. Yeah. And again, if not me, who?
Catherine, can I make a comment? I'm muted myself with Catherine.
Sure. Okay. Susan is a devout women's basketball fan, so.
Oh, okay.
I sit courtside. My husband is more devoted than I am. He watches the women's pro, the women's, anyway, he knows more about the players probably than I do. But I would like to take this back to the college level for a minute, because mm-hmm. one, FSU is now has a new coach with Brooke. And Brooke came up through the ranks. And that's a wonderful example of coaching through the ranks and how she went pro in Spain or whatever, with Ireland off Spain or wherever she went, and came back to coach. And what I've watched with these young women through the years, I've been supporting the women's basketball for a long time. What I've watched through the years is that the coaches have been able to nurture within each player, not only their own dreams, and many of them have gone on to high school, some have gone on to pros. And it is a really incredible starting place with great college coaches. I'm happy Brooke is going to be our coach for FSU now that Sue retired. But so many of them have gone on to just incredible careers, but it's in that formative years. Some of them have come, there was one player, I wish I could remember the name because my husband could. She's in the pros now and quite accomplished. She came in because when she was at FSU, when she was at high school, they said she was retarded and she couldn't do this and couldn't do that. And Coach Sue nurtured her. So those formative years in high school are just incredibly important, as well as college years. And to support the college teams is so important, I think, for all of us.
Well, I think absolutely. And I think this gets back to, again, Ella Baker, and different people have different roles. You know, there are, I mean, I think that the the WNBA has created this new kind of space where some new kinds of things can happen. And that's great. But again, one of the reasons I went through everybody else as well is that everybody's playing a role. You know, social change has to happen at all sorts of levels. It's just like just seeing, just passing a piece of federal legislation doesn't make change. Just seeing someone model change doesn't necessarily make it happen either. It all has to go. It all has to work.
Money too.
Yeah.
This is a big thing. This is a big thing. And it is available to all the college kids now, as well as the relatively new.
There's a question in the chat from my colleague, Dr. Upchurch, and he's thinking about comparisons and sort of like the historiography of like sports building character, and you know, which is obviously applies across a lot of sports and a lot of geographical boundaries. So if we're thinking about this whole idea that athletics builds particular qualities and types of character, and you're talking about the ability to protest and to stand up, what other character qualities do you think come out of the culture of women's sports?
Well, I think actually what's interesting that, you know, the ability to protest and stand up is not one of the top things you learn from athletics. And that's what I think makes the woman very interesting, because essentially, you know, in many ways, athletics is conservative as in the structure. You play a game under a series of rules, and there's a winner and a loser. And you follow the rules because those are the rules. You don't break. Well, I mean, you might try to break the rules, but the structure of it is to achieve within a particular set of rules. And when athletics has been able to mount challenges, have essentially been when it has given a platform to people who have other reasons to stand up and use the confidence they built and the platform that they have to promote change. Of course, Muhammad Ali is, you know, and the activists of the 60s are particular examples of this, that you can change, you can change ideas about people and you can use a platform to advocate. And I think that's what these women of the WNBA have done. You know, this, the WNBA has given a particular group of women who have reasons to challenge a lot of what's going on in society, has given them a platform, has given them confidence. So that's, I think, how it works. It's not, you know, there's a whole lot of athletes that are not out protesting and not changing things, because that's not really what athletics necessarily teaches you to do. But I think, you know, done well, you know, teamwork, relationships, determination, you know, coming back from setbacks. I mean, there are all sorts of great qualities that you can learn, you know, if you're not stuck in a program that's all about winning and that's the only thing. And so, I mean, I think,
Anybody else got a question they want to put in the chat? And in the meantime, can I ask you?
I think it is terrific when the women's basketball teams come from other, you know, everybody doesn't recognizes the racial inequality, and they all have their stance, but it is not so dramatic that it creates a lot of conflict. I mean, when I've gone to the women's basketball games, each team, the ACC, they kneel before the national anthem, and then they do the national anthem. And I think that it is just a really nice blending of cultural with differences among whoever is watching the games. But I don't know who decided that with the ACC, but that's what they do with the women's basketball, have been doing the women's basketball teams. They kneel before, and then they do the next from standing up.
Which is your point, right? That it's possible to, you know.
To blend it, yeah.
Can I ask a question that's been preying on my mind with Brittany Griner, which is, do you think it's possible that the WNBA salary structure will be such that women will not need to play professionally overseas?
Well, I think they are working on that now. Of course, the problem being that she was overseas in Russia because nobody makes that kind of money in the kind of money in that the WNBA that you make in the NBA or in lots of other careers as well. So she could make more money overseas. And the WNBA is actually working on that. I mean, it is a challenge. The challenge of professional athletics is that you do have to bring in revenue. And so they've actually, for the first time, the WNBA has raised, I think it's $75 million that they're going to use to invest in promotion. Because again, you have to get out to people, you have to find different ways to bring in revenue. Partly it's, you know, I mean, when we finished the book, Susan and I, one of the things that we said was essentially for women's basketball to really take off the way we'd like to see it, there's got to be a big cultural shift. People, a broader number of people, have to be delighted by seeing strong women achieving in sports. And that number of people is growing, but it's not at the same level as men. And part of that is deeply cultural. Part of it is promotion. If you see ads for men's basketball all the time and you've got the bells and whistles when they, you know, come out on the court, you know, it's helpful. And so the question is how to keep building that, how to reach the people who do delight in those things and, you know, and find a place. It's a little different from college where you have it because it's in the law, because it's education and education should be fair. You know, pro sports, it's more challenging. But I hope we will see it get better and better. And perhaps, again, I think when the players stood up for Warnock, you know, people paid attention and they got more fans. And so, you know, things like this perhaps may be able to get people to take another look, to think about what it means to support women who are doing these amazing things.
Do you think that will happen?
You know, historians are really good about saying.
I know. I'd hate it if somebody asked me that. I know.
I mean, you know, one of the challenges of women's history, as you know, as many of us know, is that things don't just keep getting better. You cannot count on things just getting better. I don't think that, college basketball is not going to go away. Women's college sports is not going to go away for the reasons that I laid out. But there's not a guarantee that we're not going to get a real, you know, turn, hard, you know, solidifying some different ideas about gender, different ideas about women are supposed to do that will, you know, provide challenges to keep what we've got rather than just making advances. I hope that won't happen. I don't, you know, like see it on the horizon, but I also, you know, I'm leery about being too optimistic. What I can say is there will always be women who are doing remarkable things and who achieve remarkable things, just like they did back in those days when they weren't, when they weren't in the spotlight. And so that's stuff that I can predict. But whether these stars will align or they can be able to bring this constellation of that level of support, that I just don't know. But people just keep working like they always have, because that's what you got to do. You work in your time and you do what you can.
I think that might be the perfect conclusive mic drop moment. can everybody join me in thanking our speaker? Thank you so much. This was fantastic.
Thank you so much.
I so, so enjoyed it. And I know from all the direct messages I was getting that everybody else just loved it as well. So
I love giving it. There's nothing I like better than to talk, and I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to think and share.